All right, so we're going to continue the sermon today, and we're going to move it into next week. We're going to try to get as much done today as possible, but we're going to finish out this topic in the next week. Now, those of you who are here for the very first time, let me just give you a quick synopsis, and then we're going to pray and get right into it. We started this journey with talking about this great battle, the controversy that Lucifer caused against God. Now, Lucifer became Satan, so this great controversy in heaven came to the planet. Now, when we take a look from Adam and Eve all the way down through the time of Christ, we notice that something interesting has happened. We've seen a decline in the human race. We have not been evolving, but in fact, we have been devolving. You know, the antediluvians, those before the flood, they lived up to 1,000 years, almost 1,000 years. They stood with great stature. There were giants in the days. And I showed you archaeological evidence of civilizations that had technologies that we today still are trying to grasp and try to understand. How did they build those pyramids? Why do we find great pyramids and great structures of cities in the under the Pacific Ocean in Japan? And we're seeing evidence in archaeology over all these amazing technologies that they discovered in India. In India, they discovered maps of the Antarctic before there was any ice. And they're wondering, how did they know that? Because only now we're verifying it with satellite. You see, I talked about how the antediluvians were a great civilization that were at the peak, at the apex of their spiritual mind. But because of their sin, God had to destroy the world. And we see evidence of that even here in Arizona in the Grand Canyon. You'll find fossils everywhere in places where you shouldn't find fossils of ocean marine life. Now, we took that concept and we said, well, how does that take us into the time of Jesus up until the last days? And so as we took this great controversy concept, we were kind of getting closer and closer and narrowing it down to the point where what is the great controversy for us right now? And I've presented some evidence to you in Revelation 13 about how the United States will play a pivotal role in last day events. But if you remember in that discussion, I didn't quite tell you the whole story, because in that there was another element, and today we're going to talk about that second element. So before we begin, let's have a word of prayer. Father in heaven, I pray now for your Holy Spirit. I pray that you speak through me, that the words spoken not be my words, but be your words. Father, we pray now for open hearts and understanding minds. It is not by accident. Those who are here today and watching online are watching this service today. You must need them to know this so that they can be ready and be prepared, their families and their friends that they might share it with. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen. Amen. Thank you for the clap, young man. That's awesome. You know what? You need to come to my church more often. I love the claps. Okay, let's talk a little bit about what we looked at so far. This is just a review. We recognized in Revelation chapter 13 that when you see a unification between Roman Catholicism together with apostate Protestantism together with spiritualism, and you see this predominantly in the Eastern religions, where they believe in transcendental meditation, they believe in coming one with the universe, with their karma, all of these spiritualistic ideas where they don't believe that man actually dies, that we are the gods. When you see the unification, this trifecta here, occur, Revelation 13 tells us that we are getting closer to the end time. This is just review. Now, you remember I told you that up until 2021, we've been waiting for the perfect union. But you recognize that this actually happened in the Laodicea See of the papacy. It was through global climate where the Roman Catholicism and all the Protestant churches and over 40 world religions came together. And now they are unified in trying to save the planet. They weren't going to God asking for God to help. They're saying, we can do it ourselves. You see, this issue of being humanism, transhumanism, this idea that we can become the gods, this is the same problem that the antediluvians had. You see, the antediluvians thought that they can build great towers and great edifices, and that way they can not be destroyed. And God had to show them that there is still a God in heaven. Well, we're now getting to that point now. But in Revelation 13, we notice that something else happens here. We notice that there will be a unification of all the world governments, where all the world governments will stand in awe after this beast power that we see in Revelation 13. So here is the world governments. Have we seen a unification of this trifecta with world governments? It just happened last week in the COP meetings. In other words, they're trying to get the whole world, 120 nations, together. There are only 213 of them, okay, that exist according to the United Nations. But here we notice that the world governments are now meeting to help control global climate change. And you might say, well, Pastor, I didn't come here to hear about global climate change. I came here to hear about the Word of God. But I'm telling you that progressive revelation, something has happened that has never happened in history before. We have seen a unification of all the world religions, and we have seen all the world governments come together, and they are now together for one common mission. And I mentioned to you there are things that they're now talking about, things like Green Sabbath. They're trying to push for a Green Sabbath. And guess what that Green Sabbath is? They are giving it another name. They're calling it Climate Sunday. This is new. This has never existed before. So what Satan is doing is taking this issue that belongs in the world of politics and in the environment. It has now come under the auspices of the church. The church is now influencing world governments to create a solution that moves us towards a Green Sabbath or a Climate Sunday. Now, you might be saying, wow, I would not have ever guessed that this would have come in my lifetime. But I'm telling you right now, this is happening right now. So this is up-to-date news. Now, you all, what I'm talking about, you may have heard about in the 70s, the 80s, and the 90s, the unification of the church and another power. But you have not had the facts that you can now fill in to the spaces. And here's what I'm doing today. I'm filling the spaces now. Now, there's something else that happens. This is what I talked about last week. Something is going to happen that will now move the United States of America into a position of influence. And in this influence, we notice that the USA is going to create an image. We read this last week. And this image is going to be something that goes back to the first beast. Now, you notice I drew the line, and I did that presumptuously. But I'm going to prove to you that the first beast today is this. Now, I'm not putting any Catholics down. I'm not even putting the Pope Francis down. What I'm talking about is a historical development of something that happened in the Christian church that positioned itself in a way that fulfilled prophecy. And now today, we are now in a position where something is going to happen where if you do not bow down to worship that, you will receive what we know as the mark of the beast. This is the fundamental question. What is the mark of the beast? But you won't understand what the mark of the beast is unless you understand who are the players involved in enforcing the mark of the beast. Now, I'm just going to repeat this again from last week. You know, the microchip, your credit cards, buying and selling, not the ability to buy or sell. That is not the mark of the beast. That is not the mark of the beast. But that is a way to enforce the mark of the beast. Okay? What the mark of the beast is something totally different. What is the mark of the beast? You want to make sure you don't receive it. But if you don't receive it, guess what's going to happen? There's only going to be one of two crowds. You're either going to get the mark of the beast, or you're going to follow God and receive his seal. There's only one of two choices. You won't have a choice other than that, because if you can't buy or sell, you're going to die. Right? Unless you're prepared. So God encoded a message, a prophecy, and he put it in code because it was a message that he needed to give to the church in the first century AD, and particularly those of us at the end of time. This message is for us today. God encoded this prophecy to protect the integrity of this message. God, in 2,000 years ago, back in 90 AD, said, I got to let my people know in the last days what is going to happen. So he gave a prophecy to John the Revelator, and he packaged it, and he encoded it, and he says, no one will be able to understand that prophecy through time. And then it's going to start to get revealed, but they're not going to know all the facts until need be at the end of time. I'm telling you right now that what you're going to hear today might be a little offensive, might be a little bit surprising, but I'm going to ask you that you just stand back and not find yourself loyal to a denomination or to a tag, but rather ask yourself the question, what does the God of all of heaven need me to know about the last days? Because this message encoded is something that God needs you to have. And when Jesus comes again, he's not coming back for a Catholic. He's not coming back for a Seventh-day Adventist. When God comes out of that eastern sky and the sky is rolling back, he's not going to say, oh, you Baptists, come before me. He's not going to be saying, oh, you Lutherans, come before me. No, he's coming back and he's saying, which one of you has a relationship with me? Which one of you has followed the unadulterated truth of my scripture? Come before me. It doesn't matter where you have come from, what traditions you hold, what your family line has been. Those things are not going to save you. Only God will save you. So, therefore, learn what God needs you to know. Yes. Now, we're going to take a look at something, and I'm going to break it down real fast and simple for you. There are some truths in Scripture that God created down at the beginning of creation. He inspired certain individuals, and they wrote down what God told them. And they didn't know what they were quite writing. They were writing some symbols, and they didn't know quite what those interpretations were. But it was the same Holy Spirit, the same God that was giving the impression on these individuals. So when you take a look, and you're going down through time, and you take a look at Adam and Eve, and we look at the book of Genesis, we notice that it starts with this prophecy where it says that your seed will bruise the head of that snake. That's the beginning of a prophecy that now takes us to Matthew. Matthew 24, Jesus is about ready to be crucified, a fulfillment of that prophecy. But in that, in Matthew 24, God gives us an insight into something that occurs in the last days. Now, what we're seeing here is what I call a golden thread. Okay, so in other words, what I'm going to show you, this encoded message, you can't just look at one area. The whole Bible has to explain it. And you have to understand it. So as we go through it, we start to see that there are some influences in the book of Daniel, chapter 2 and chapter 7. As we look into this, we look into the book of Ezekiel. All of these writers were writing with the same Holy Spirit, and they're putting together a golden thread of interpretation that would then lead us to the book of Revelation. And we look at Revelation chapter 13 and Revelation chapter 17. When you take a look at all of these books, and then you throw into this 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, look at what it says here. You heard it? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, there's this great apostasy. So if you read that text just by itself, it doesn't make any sense. But when you add it together with Revelation 13 and Revelation chapter 17, you begin to see that there is a package that God has put together. So therefore, you can't understand Revelation unless you read the Old Testament of Daniel. You need both. If you try to understand Daniel and say, I don't understand Revelation, you're going to miss half the message. If you try to unpackage Revelation and you don't know Daniel and 2 Thessalonians, you're going to say, I don't know what they're talking about. It's confusing. I don't know. I'm just going to let that go, and I'll just give my life to Jesus. But if you're going to survive in these last days, God needs you to know a particular message. And what you have to read are all of these together. These are golden threads that connect everything together and packages it together that uncodifies or decodifies a very important message for us in the last days. Amen? So, what are we going to do today? First of all, as we look at prophecy, one thing you're going to notice is God starts with the general. And then he starts to take it down closer and closer down into the specific until the point where you can now start to fill certain blanks in it. So there are some things I'm going to presume that you actually know. For example, I'm going to presume that you know the prophecies given in Daniel chapter 2. I'm not going to talk about Daniel chapter 2. So if you haven't read Daniel chapter 2, there's a small point of what I'm talking about today that you might be lost. I'm also not going to talk about Daniel 7. I'm only going to mention it. But I'm going to tell you something. You will not understand Revelation 13 if you haven't read Daniel chapter 2 and Daniel chapter 7. You can't. It's impossible. So I'm only going to refer to it. Now, if you are interested in knowing, I'm going to encourage you to talk to me and we'll study together. I'm actually going to be doing a whole prophecy series starting in January next year. In Daniel and Revelation, if you want to get down and you want to see what is happening now and relook at those prophecies, make sure you sign up for that, okay? So I'm not going to mention this. I'm not even going to mention Matthew 24. And today I just had Sister Desiree read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. But when she was reading it, I saw your reaction. I heard your reaction. I heard the gasp. I heard the, oh, right? Because maybe you didn't know that what they're talking about in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 is actually things that we see in great detail in Revelation chapter 13 and in Revelation chapter 17. So we're only going to touch on this, but you're going to have to read the whole package in order to understand and break down what we see here in Revelation chapter 13. So let's go right to this. Revelation chapter 13, verse 1 through 4 tells us, "Then I stood on the sand of the sea." Now, I gave you the code of interpretation. When you are watching something come out of the sea, we're talking about something that is coming out of an area of mass population, where there is a civilization of peoples that are all gathered together. So here we see that this beast is rising up out of that sea. So in beast and prophecy is symbolic of what? What is a beast? A kingdom. So here we see a nation, a kingdom that is going to come up out of an area of high population. Now, most nations today come from areas of mass population, okay? Having seven heads and 10 horns. This is kind of the point where people start to get lost. I want you to remember that, seven heads. We're going to circle back on that in just a minute. 10 horns. Horns in prophecy is symbolic. I gave you the keys 2 weeks ago. Horn is symbolic of what? A subsequent power that comes up out of a place, a nation, a head, okay? And on his horns, there were crowns or diadems, which means that these powers are going to be monarchies, nations that have kings and queens. So clearly we're seeing a message here that God gave to John the Revelator in 90 AD, during a time when there were monarchies. Now, I want to mention something real quick. Let's just time out for a second. You realize that the Bible is not meant just for you, right? A lot of times we think the Bible is just meant for me. You realize that there are people that existed before you, like people in 70 AD, 90 AD, the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, all the way through the middle, dark ages, right? So you would think that God has messages for them as well. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at this prophecy as a big package. You can't just say this belongs just to me, to those of us. We have to look at the whole historical package and see how it was fulfilled. Amen? Now, it says here, on their heads, or on this head, it had a blasphemous name. We're going to talk about blasphemy. So I want you to remember those seven heads, and I want you to remember, what is blasphemy? I'm going to answer that question. What is it? Verse 2 says, "Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear. His mouth was like the mouth of a lion." Now, those of you who have studied prophecy, those of you who have studied scripture know that you've seen this before. It wasn't just in the New Testament, because when you saw the sequence of a leopard, a bear, and a lion, and here it says an undescribable dragon giving him power, a throne, and great authority, we're seeing a nation that's coming up that is a composite beast derived from some images out of Daniel chapter 7. Daniel chapter 7. But it goes on. Verse 3 says, "And I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was what? healed. In other words, when I say I was mortally wounded, that means I'm dead. I'm dead. You know, how dead am I when I'm dead? I'm completely dead. But yet somehow this thing comes back to life. A miracle happens. Like it's completely eradicated, and yet somehow the world is marveling and follows this beast because somehow its deadly wound got healed. So we have to look for a nation who rose up out of a great civilization, who had blasphemy on its head, that derived out of seven, from an area of monarchies, and here we notice was wounded to death but ended up being healed. Well, we go on in verse 4. What happens? The world then worships the dragon. So I want you to recognize something very interesting here. I talked about this first beast. Last week, we talked about the second beast in Revelation 13. But make no mistake about it, Satan is behind it all. Satan is giving it the power to both. Because it says here, they worship the dragon. What does the dragon represent in prophecy? Satan. Satan is behind giving authority to that first beast. We got to be sure who that first beast is then. And they worship that beast, saying, who can be like that beast? Who is able to make war with him? It's impossible to kill it. We tried and we failed. So we're looking at something very, very unique. The Bible mentions a dragon and this first beast. And last week we took a great length of time to talk about the second beast. But it doesn't end here. There's something that combines with that first beast in the last days. And we have not seen it until just now in 2021. We have not seen the union of the first and second beast until recently. And this is why I'm bringing it up again as your pastor. This is not an easy sermon to discuss. I ask for your prayers because no pastor wants to give a sermon that creates enemies. But you see, I serve a risen Savior and an almighty God, and I must be faithful to the word of God. Amen? And so I'm not here to get anyone upset and really mad at me. I'm here just to reveal the truth, and you do with it what you will. So let's take a look at this. Beast in prophecy represents kingdoms. We've seen it in Daniel chapter 7. We notice that these four beasts very quickly represents the lion is Babylon. We notice that when we looked at the bear, it was the Medes and the Persians. This is why it was leaning to one side. The Persians took dominance. When we looked at the leopard with the four wings, the four heads represented the four generals of Alexander the Great. They were moving swiftly, conquering the world. Then we come to the indescribable fourth beast, which is where we land right now. That fourth beast that we see here in Daniel 7 is the first beast of Revelation chapter 13. So God picked up the prophecy from Daniel, and he carried it several hundred years into Revelation. So here's what it says. Daniel chapter 2 and Daniel 7, we see a comparison. We see that the head of gold, Babylon, was that lion. That the arms of silver were the Medes and the Persians, Greece, that bronze thigh with the leopard. And then the two legs, was Rome. So this composite beast that we notice here in Revelation chapter 13 is a influence, a mixture, a composite of both the temporal and the spiritual influences of Babylon, Persia, and Greece. In other words, take all the powers of Babylon, add it to the powers of Persia, add it to the powers of Greece, and you have now that fourth beast. Do we see that today in ancient Rome? Of course. Look at the gods of Rome. The god Jupiter is like saying Zeus. The way they worship was Eastern Persian Zoroastrianism. The Akkadian civilization and the Phoenician gods, Baal, and all of those Egyptian gods, Isis and Osiris, you will find elements of that in the Vatican. You thought that what you're looking at is the mother and child, the Madonna and Jesus. No, what you're looking at is Isis and Osiris. They carried all of the influences of every civilization that preceded it, and they adopted all those cultures, and they brought it into Rome. Into Rome. So here's what we notice. There are six characteristics that we read here. Verse 2 tells us the dragon gave him the power, gave him his seat, and great authority. In other words, they didn't get it on their own. They didn't do it through victory of war. They got it because something miraculous happened, something spiritual occurred. The dragon, Satan, gave his own authority, gave his own power, and transferred all of his authority to this pagan system, this pagan civilization known as pagan Rome. So let's take a look at it. The Babylonian Empire leads to the Medo-Persian Empire, the Grecian Empire. If you're lost right now, this is Daniel chapter 2 and Daniel chapter 7. From Greece, we went into the Roman Empire, but from Rome, it transitions into something what we call the Holy Roman Empire. So Rome disintegrated into something different, where it then divided into the 10 kingdoms or the 10 toes that we see in the Daniel 2 prophecy. Now, I know some of this is just review for you, but I want to just go through this history a little bit. When did that happen? Up to this point, from the time of Peter and Paul and all the disciples, you know, those Christians were persecuted. They were killed. How is it all of a sudden that Christianity is the new religion in town? Why is that now the new thing? Because in 350 AD, Constantine aligned himself with a power, the papacy. And we notice that in this alignment, something unusual happened in that year, that in 350, Constantine donated his capital to the Bishop of Rome. So he vacated the capital of Rome. I don't know if you know this, but the Roman Empire capital did not remain in Rome. It went to Constantinople in Turkey. So that was the new Roman Empire in Constantinople. Well, he didn't leave Rome vacated. What he did was he just handed his authority over to the Bishop of Rome. So we see the Revelation prophecy starting to be fulfilled all the way back to the 3rd century. But it goes further than that. Take a look at Baldassar Labanca. He's a professor of history at the University of Rome. I pulled this statement from him. He gives a history of this. To the succession of the Caesars, Augustus Caesar, Julius Caesar, came the succession of the pontiffs in Rome. In other words, according to the Catholic Church, according to history, remember, I'm not downing Catholics. I'm giving a history lesson here. It says, when Constantine left Rome, he gave his seat of authority over to the pontiff. He didn't leave it vacated, because he knew that the pontiff in Rome would be able to represent the Roman Empire. Now remember, the Roman Empire was pagan. How is it that you would turn over a pagan empire over to a Christian organization? It's because Constantine had a vision and he became Christian himself. And his mom became Christian. So he said Christianity must be the end religion. And so because of that, he now made it cool to be a Christian. And this, we start to see a fulfillment of prophecy. It goes on. Stanley's History, page 40, tells us that the popes filled the place of the vacant emperors of Rome. They inherited their power. They inherited their prestige. And the tides from paganism did not leave the church. It actually remained in Rome. It actually remained. It goes on. It says that Constantine left all to the Bishop of Rome. So he basically just left a turnkey operation over to the Bishop of Rome. This is why we call it Roman Catholicism, not Christian Catholicism, because it is Roman. In other words, it went from pagan Rome over to papal Rome. This is the transition. In fact, we notice this. It says the papacy is but the ghost of the deceased Roman Empire. In other words, they're saying that when you look at Roman Catholicism, you're basically looking at pagan Rome. Okay? And it says here that they are still crowned with the same kinds of things and the same kinds of privileges as pagan Rome. Now, this is a date that's going to be very important. In fact, it is so important, I'm going to write it up here. Okay, can I erase this right here? I'm going to erase this here. All right, those of you who are watching online, I know we have a lot of young people watching online. You can watch the video on this. Unfortunately, hopefully someone Snapchat shot this up here. I just erased it. Did you get it? Please send it to me. I got a bunch of young people who are saying, Pastor, I need that board again for you. Sorry, I forgot to do that. So send me the photos. Okay, 538 AD is the start point. 538 AD. What happened in 538 AD? I'm giving you a quick history lesson. Here we see that pagan Rome essentially becomes papal Rome under what they call now the first holy emperor, Justinian. Okay, so this is under the Holy Roman Emperor. So this is where we find the combination between church and state. This is Justinian. This earmarks right here in the timeline of history that gets us to Revelation 13, the point of something that occurs. This is when we begin to see the first Holy Roman Emperor, Justinian, the combination of church and state, and look at what happens after that. So we notice, now I want to mention this. I got to say this. I've got a lot of Catholics watching me online. I don't want to upset you. There are many honest Catholics watching me from around the world. I've got people in India watching me right now. I'm only being faithful to what God is showing me. And I need to reveal that to you. Some of you are hearing this for the very first time. Some of you have heard this before. Okay, you need to just pray for me right now if you heard this before. Because I guarantee you there's 50% of you watching right now that are being hit from the left side. You've never heard this before. Okay, there are many, many honest people. If you are a great Catholic, praise the Lord. We all need to be as devout and reverent and awe-inspired as Catholics when we come into our own sanctuary. Okay? The problem with Protestants today, they've lost respect for God. This is something that Catholics still have that we need to get ourselves. Okay? There are some things that Catholics do around the world that Protestants are so far behind on. They're worried about the poor. They're worried about getting into inner cities. I think Protestants, if you really want to do what God's will is, you need to follow what Catholics are doing. Okay, some of them are doing great work. I'm not downing Catholics. I'm only showing you a historical evidence of prophecy that takes us into something that's going to be very alarming for us in the last days. Okay, so I don't know what just happened there. Let me go on. Now, we notice in this prophecy that it will have power over Western Europe. In other words, it will be very influential in the area that the beast rises up out of the sea. So if it is true that this first beast is papal Rome or pagan Rome, then its influence is going to be in the European area. That makes sense, right? Have we seen that? Okay, Revelation 13:4 tells us they worship the dragon who gave authority to the beast, and they worship the beast, saying, "Who is like that beast? Who is able to make war with him?" And as you notice and you go down through time, there are many governments and kingdoms that try to make war against the papal see, that try to make war against papal Rome. But what has happened through history? We've noticed that they weren't able to make war with the papacy. In other words, they made unions together with it. They were able to do things in a way that was in their self-interest, but they come out of those meetings doing something on behalf of papal Rome. We see it happening right now with President Biden. We see it happen with Obama. So it doesn't matter if it's Democrat or Republican. I'm apolitical. I don't care if you're Republican or Democrat. There's still two horns on the same beast. Satan is wielding it any which way. Okay? You have to be beyond the politics of America and the world. You are citizens of the kingdom of heaven. Open your eyes and see what is going on around the world. We've seen it happen in England. We've seen it with Hitler. Every single one of these world leaders have tried to make unions with the papacy. Why? What is so important about them? You see another fulfillment in prophecy. Revelation 13:7 says that authority was given him over every tribe, every tongue, every nation. Now, I'm going to show you a slide here that there are more Roman Catholics more than any other Christian system on the planet today. Did you know that? Take a look at this. There are over 1.3 billion Catholics and they're growing. It's amazing. It's a universal system and they have authority over every tribe, every tongue, over every nation. If you look even here in the United States, there are 647 million. There are only 20 million Seventh-day Adventists. Even in the United States, we're already a minority. Take a look in Africa, 251 million, 10 million down in the South Pacific, 149 million in the 10-20 area where there shouldn't be any Christians at all, only Muslims and Hindus and Buddhists and Catholics are there. So we see something of an influence that we've not seen ever in the history of the planet. Now, there is a third characteristic. I love this slide because it really shocks a lot of my youth and young adults. Did you know that this is the throne of the Pope? Take a look at that. Does that look like any throne room you've ever seen? And it's scary. It's terrifying. Okay, this, if you want to have audience with the Pope, you have to go into this. Okay? What is that third characteristic? Verse 5 and 6 tells us, and there was given unto him a mouth, and that mouth was speaking great things, and those great things were blasphemous to God. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name. Now, I'm not going to tell you that the Pope and Roman Catholics or apostate Protestants or Eastern religions intentionally want to do this. But remember, the voice is coming from Satan. And so they inevitably are inclined to do something, and it's speaking the voice of Satan. And it's blaspheming against God. Well, what is this? He was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. He opened his mouth in blasphemy, again in verse 6, blaspheming God's name. What is actually blasphemy? Well, we take a look at scriptures real quick. John 10, verse 33, here's the legal definition. The Jews answered, saying, for good work, we do not want to stone you, Jesus, but for blasphemy. What is blasphemy? Because you, being a man, are making yourself God. So you see, blasphemy, according to scripture, is when you take a man and claims the privileges and the authority of the Almighty God of heaven. So what we're seeing is a beast power that is going to come up who will proclaim to have the privileges and the authorities of the Almighty God. And they're going to combine with the United States to enforce the mark of the beast that's about to happen to you in the next several years. So open your eyes and see what's going to happen. A power that will assume God's authority and his title. Check out his crown. Do you know what the tiara actually represents? I'm going to talk about it in just a minute. Father, forgive me, for I have sinned. And who are they asking for forgiveness from? A man, a priest. Let me tell you something, that this claim that you can forgive someone is blasphemy. Because me as a pastor, any priest as a mortal human, do not have power to forgive sins. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that only God can forgive sins. But take a look at what the Ecclesiastical Dictionary talks about on the Pope. The Pope is of so great dignity. The Pope is so exalted that he is not a mere man. He's not a man. But as it were, he is God. The Pope is God. And he is the substitute, the vicar of God. In other words, you have God here. Don't worry about it. You've got the Pope. You got the best thing in-house right now. This is their legal definition. He is likewise the divine monarch. Interesting that they use monarch. Remember the crowns. He is a royalty. He is above all. In other words, in a monarchy, I don't care what you say. What I say determines the law. Right? That's what a monarchy. This is not a democracy here. We're talking about a monarchy. And a supreme what? An emperor. Man, this almost sounds like Empire Strikes Back from Star Wars. Okay? He is the supreme emperor, and he is the king of all kings. I don't know about you, but the last time I heard about the king of kings was Jesus Christ. Amen. But this is how they define it. So that if it be possible, that even if angels sinned, and if angels erred, that they would have to go them directly to the Pope, lest the angels be excommunicated out of heaven. In other words, angels, you better beware. Don't be messing with me because I'll send the Pope on you. I will execute. This is what they believe. This is the legal definition. This has not changed, folks. Hasn't changed. Okay, now let's go on. We hold upon the earth the place of God Almighty. Okay, that's dangerous. When you actually declare that you, a man, now are God on earth, that you can forgive sins and you can even forgive angels. You know, you think that's bad. There's even more claims of privileges that they have claimed. Now, remember, I'm not talking about any individual. I'm not talking about a group of people. I'm talking about a system that occurred as a result of prophetic evolution. Okay? Now, take a look at this. Jesus was accused of forgiving sins. How is it that Jesus can actually forgive sins? Who is this who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? Interesting, you should ask that question about Jesus. Because he's actually God. Jesus can't forgive sins. So was he actually committing blasphemy? No. Jesus isn't committing blasphemy because he can actually forgive sins. But the Jews rejected Jesus. They thought that he was just a man. Jesus can actually forgive sins because he is actually God himself. 1 Timothy 2:5 says, "For there is only one God, there is only one mediator that comes between God and you, and that is Jesus Christ. There is only one way to the Father, that is Jesus Christ." You can't go to a priest, you can't give money, your denomination will not save you, your pastor will not save you. If you want help from the Almighty God, you go to Jesus Christ yourself. As a matter of fact, in the Catholic Priest, page 7879, here's what this says. "Seek where you will, though heaven and earth, and you will find but one created being who can forgive the sinner." Who do you think that is, anyone? Who do you think that is? It should be Jesus, right? That extraordinary being is the priest. This is coming from them now. Okay? This is coming from them. According to my Bible in 1 Timothy, the person I go to is Jesus Christ. But it says here that, okay, let me go back. Look at the language. "Heaven and earth, you will find but one created being who can forgive your sins." Only one? That extraordinary being is the priest. And they really specified it, the Catholic priest. So if you're an Anglican priest, if you're a Presbyterian priest, if you are a Jewish rabbi, if you're an Adventist pastor, man, you're without hope. You've got to be a Catholic priest in order to be forgiven, according to the Catholic priest. Look at this, Dignity and Duties of the Priest, volume 12, page 2. "God himself," they say, "is obliged to abide by the judgment of the priest." Are you kidding me? Who's God here? Who's God here? Does God tell me what to do and I do it? Yes. I pray that God uses me. God, tell me what you need me to do. Send me. Here I am. I will go. But according to what I'm reading here, that God himself is obliged to do what I say. Who's God here? Who's wagging the tail? Is the tail wagging the dog? Or is the dog wagging the tail? God himself is obliged to abide by the judgment of his priest and either not to pardon or to pardon. In other words, if I claim that you are a sinner and you are out with heaven, God says, cool with me, whatever. Thank God I serve a risen Savior that sees me personally, right? Man judges on the outside. Only God can judge me on the inside. According as they refuse or give the absolution, God has to abide by this. The sentence of the priest precedes God, and God must subscribe to it. Man, those are some bold words. Those are some fighting words when it comes to God. If I'm the watchman on the tower, and I heard someone say that out in the army field, I'm going to say, come on, battle, let's go. You just defended my God. I'm like David. Give me some 5 stones. I'm going to take you out. You know, I don't like these kinds of words. You know, telling me that my God, the Almighty God that created the universe, has to abide by you? No. We follow God and God only. But this is what they say, and this has not changed in over 2,000 years. We can go directly to Jesus, brothers and sisters. Amen. We need no priest. We don't need to go to a confessional. Your confessional is your own bedroom, your own bathroom, your own closet. You get down on your knees. You can sit down. You can be in your recliner chair. You could be driving. I don't care where you are. God doesn't care where you are. You take it to the Lord wherever you are. You have a connection to the Lord. You have a connection to the Lord. You are the temple of God. You don't have to go to Jerusalem and see the Shekinah glory in the most holy place. The most holy place is here. The most holy place is here. You are the holy temple. You go to God. Jesus is your high priest. Jesus is the one interceding for you. You don't need an earthly person, and yet here's what they claim, and it's in prophesied in Revelation chapter 13, prophesied in Daniel chapter 2, Daniel chapter 7, Revelation chapter 17, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, Matthew chapter 24. It is a package of encoded messages to tell you that something is about to come down in the end times. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. God is faithful to cleanse you from all your unrighteousness. This is a promise that you can bank on. Yes. Take it to the Lord in prayer. God will cleanse you. You don't take the soap and you start rubbing yourself down. You don't get your loofah soap and start doing this to yourself. If you do that, you're going to miss a spot. So you stand there and you go, God, take me. You turn around. You missed a spot, Lord. Come on, over here. You let the Lord clean you. And he will be faithful and just to forgive you of every single sin. You might think that you have a bad sin. Murder. adultery, rape. Give me a sin, any sin, lifestyle issue. There's not a sin that God can't forgive. Amen. Nothing. Amen. Oh, I have a family member and a friend who is homosexual. So that person's not going to be in heaven. Where in the Bible does it say that that person can't go to God and say, Lord, forgive me of my sins? And God's going to say, I forgive you of your sins. Amen. You can't judge people. God is the judge of us all. Amen. We all go to Jesus. And we ask for forgiveness. And God is faithful and just to cleanse us. Revelation 13:7 goes on and says it was granted to him to make war with the saints. So here we see the second beast power will rise up, and it has a special job that Satan has given it. Its special job is to now make war against God's people, the saints. Revelation 14:12 tells us that here is the definition, the patience of the saints. These are those who keep the God's commandments and have the faith and testimony of Jesus Christ. Have we seen that in history? Western Watchman, December 23rd, 1908, article comes out. The church has persecuted, period. And only a tyro in church history will deny that. We have seen it in the Inquisition. Thank you, Sister Darcy, wherever you are, who corrected me from last week. I mentioned the Spanish Inquisition. That paled in comparison to the actual Inquisition. Because in the actual Inquisition, it was this pagan system of worship that caused the martyrdom of 50 million people. People? 50 million. It's harsh when I see one person die. Makes me cry. I've been on the killing fields of Cambodia, and I walked on the skulls and the bones of over 10,000 individuals that were murdered at the hands of the Khmer Rouge. And I felt so sick, one of my members on my evangelistic team was throwing up. I couldn't even handle it. 10,000, 50 million. 50 million at the hands of this pagan system. They were all killed. They were all martyred because of their faith. And who were these individuals? These are individuals that stood up against the Roman Catholic Church. These are individuals that kept the Sabbath. These are individuals that followed the unadulterated truths of Scripture. Now, if you claim to be one of these people that follow Scriptures, guess what? You're in the same line as those martyrs that were martyred in the past. Don't get too comfortable, because the Revelation prophecy tells us that there will be a union between the two beasts. It will be the United States that will enforce the mark of the beast so bad that even a death decree is going to go out. And you might say, wow, I don't believe it. It can't happen. What are you talking about? It's already happened. We repeat history all the time as a human race. Take a look at this. Edward Peters, J.D. I'm watching this guy. I'm pretty sure that there will come a time, if God willing, I'm alive at the time of the end. I'm probably going to see him on another side of a courtroom. He is the Catholic priest. Public ecclesiastical canon law is the oldest continuously functioning legal system in the Western world today. How many of you ever heard of the public ecclesiastical canon law? You have? Okay, let's talk about this for a second. This is the official public legal system of the Catholic Church. Public ecclesiastical canon law affects virtually every aspect of faith of life over 1 billion Catholic Christians around the world. And guess what? In 1983, Pope St. John Paul II publicized the code as still binding today. Okay, now you might say, well, Pastor, that's cool. Why do I need to know that? Okay, you want to hear something? Check this out. Public Ecclesiastical Law, Volume 2, page 142. The church may by divine right confiscate any property of a heretic. If you're deemed a heretic, your house that you own, that car that you own, gone. They have, by divine right, they claim, to take your possessions. Check this out. Page 142, public ecclesiastical law, still in effect today. They can imprison you and your family and condemn you to flames. They can kill you. In our age, the right to inflict the severest penalties, even death, belongs to the church. They claim that they have the right to take your life. They claim that they have the right to do whatever they want to you, because they were given that right by God himself. There is no graver offense than heresy. What is heresy? A belief contrary to the church. Now, I'm going to tell you something. Did I write it up here? Climate Sunday, Green Sabbath, if you don't agree with it, I'm telling you, this public ecclesiastical law is still in play right now. Therefore, that heretical movement must be rooted out. Now, this message goes out to the minority of Sabbath keepers who are listening to me right now. This is not a time to fear. This is not a time to fear, because I will see 100 fall at my right and a 10,000 at my left. I serve a powerful God. You know, the Israelites said, the Ark of the Covenant goes before me, I can conquer anything. They missed out on something. The Ark of the Covenant means nothing. What matters is God in the Ark going before you. If God be for you, if God is for you, who can be against you? Lift your heads up. Look up to the sky. Your redemption draws nigh. Don't worry about your life. Don't worry about your things. Those things belong to God anyways. If God takes them, so be it. Because you see, you can take my little home that needs paint and stucco. I've got a mansion in heaven right now where moth or rust does not decay. You can take my car whose bumper has fallen off. You see, because I'm going to be riding horses and animals and friends in heaven. I might even be able to fly myself. I don't need a car in heaven. Gold, all your possessions in your bank, who cares about that? Because in heaven, streets are made of gold. Now imagine that. Imagine that now. Here, we use asphalt for our streets. In heaven, gold means nothing. We use gold for our streets in heaven, right? Proverbs 16:25 tells us there is a way that might seem right to a man, but in the end, it leads to death. So therefore, this is an appeal to those of you watching and those of you here today. Don't get stuck in your tradition. Don't get stuck in your denomination. Don't get stuck with your tag. In fact, if you call yourself a Seventh-day Adventist because you believe in the seventh-day Sabbath and you believe in the second coming of Christ, you can also call yourself a Baptist because you believe in baptism by immersion. You can call yourself a Methodist because you believe in a methodological way of studying the Bible that leads you into a relationship. Like the Lutherans, call yourself a Lutheran, where we are saved by faith and not by works alone. You can call yourself anything you want. You can call me anything you want. You know, the thing I want to be called is a child of God. And this is something that I'm appealing to everyone. Do not follow the ways of a tradition or a man. Follow God himself. Let's do some biblical mathematics here. Revelation 13:5 tells us that he was given a mouth speaking great things. We talked about the blasphemy. He was given authority to continue for 42 months. Now, let's talk about those 42 months. Those of you with calculators, 42 months is equal to how many days? 1,260 days, right? But we noticed something. I mentioned Ezekiel. You see, you won't understand this if you didn't read the prophecies in Ezekiel. So let's take a look at what Ezekiel says. Ezekiel chapter 4, verse 6 tells us that whenever you read prophecy, when you see the word days, you're actually really meaning years. Okay? Now, I'm guaranteeing you right now, some of you saying, I know this already. I've heard this before. But I guarantee you that over 50% listening to this sermon right now has never heard this before. Mark this time down. Ezekiel chapter 4, verse 6. Go back to every prophecy and add the day to the year principle, and it will blow your mind. God has given us a package of truth. So he says, from 538, go down to 1,260 years, and something's going to happen. Those of you with calculators, tell me, add 538 to 1,260 years, and what do I get? 1798. So according to this prophecy, something should happen in 1798. So it says that these 1,260 literal years from the time where pagan Rome became papal Rome, something will happen. So in this time of period, in 1798, it says that it will receive a wound and something will happen to that. So let's take a look. Holy Roman Emperor Justinian, 538 AD. What happens in 1798? Let's look at that real quickly. It says, I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded. So according to this prophecy, something is going to happen to this first beast. This pagan papal system is going to get injured in 1798. Now, those of you who are historians know what happened. Napoleon is now sweeping across Europe. And wouldn't you know it, not in 1797, not in 1799, but exactly the year 1798, General Berthier, under the instructions of Napoleon, goes into the Holy City, captures the Pope, and declares that papacy is now over. That is the wound that killed the papal church. It was never to rise again. According to Church History, page 24, the murder of a Frenchman in Rome in 1798 gave the French an excuse for occupying the Eternal City and putting an end to the papal temporal power. Okay, this is when it occurred. The aged pontiff himself was carried off into exile to Valence. The enemies of the church were rejoicing. The last pope, they declared, had reigned. So according to prophecy, it says that after the 1,260 years, something would happen in 1798, and what we see in 1798 is Napoleon. Napoleon went in there and destroyed the papal system. So there it is, right there. Now, we notice something in Revelation 17, verse 1 through 9. So very quickly, we're running short on time. I apologize for that, but I believe I need to finish this message to you. Do you all agree with me? Okay. Revelation 17, verse 1 and 9. It says, "Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with me, saying to me, 'Come, I will show you a judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth committed fornication.'" So we see the language repeating itself from Revelation 13. But now we're driving a little deeper. It says, "The inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me in the spirit into the wilderness, and I looked, and I saw this woman that was sitting on that scarlet beast." The beast that we're seeing here is the same beast in Revelation 13. But we see a new player. We see a woman. A woman in prophecy is symbolic of a what? A church. So a church is now sitting on this world empire, this pagan system, okay? And look at what happens. The woman and the beast become sort of one. It says it was filled with names of blasphemy. And look at here. It had the same seven heads and 10 horns. Okay, so we are looking at a deeper expository of Revelation 13. But here we notice a symbol of interpretation. Look at verse 4. "The woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls." That's very important because if you look at the papal seat today, what are their colors? You're looking at this now. This is why today I didn't wear purple, because I would have thought, you might have thought that I was representing the papacy. Okay, so I'm wearing red today for blood. "Having in her hand a golden cup full of abominations and the filthiness of her fornication." Again, it's a repeat of Daniel 2, Daniel 7, Revelation 13, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. But look at what it says in verse 5. "On her forehead a name was written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and of the abominations of the earth. I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I marveled with great amazement. The angel says to me, 'Why are you marveling? I'm going to give you the interpretation. I'm going to give you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, which has the seven heads and the 10 horns. The beast that you saw was..." He was, but now is not, mortally wounded. But he will ascend again, okay, from the bottomless pit and go into perdition, a future prophecy. "Those who dwell on earth will marvel, whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world." So we're talking about a system that's going to impact people who do not receive the mark of God. These are people not written in the book of life. "When they see the beast that was and is not and yet is, here is the mind which has wisdom." Whenever the Bible tells you that, start to write down. We're about ready to interpret for you. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. If you're not sure who this nation is, look at Revelation 17. Now begin to look at all the nations. Who was built on seven hills? Okay, let's take a look. The seven hills of Rome. Pagan Rome and papal Rome were built exactly on the city of seven hills. They even call themselves the city of seven hills. The Bible was clear, folks. The Bible was absolutely crystal clear on where this was happening. Revelation 13:3, going back, says, "I saw one of the heads as if it had been mortally wounded. His deadly wound was then healed. All the world marveled and followed after the beast. All who dwell on earth will worship it, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb. We notice that it's repeat language in Revelation 17, but there, you have to use both. Here is wisdom, let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a who? A man. His number is 666. Now, I know some of you have been waiting all week long to discover what is the 666. God told us what it is. It's the number of a man. Okay, let's break it down. Now, some of you don't know this, but John the Revelator wrote this book, given this inspiration, in 90 AD. Who was the prevailing empire at the time that John was given the vision in Revelation? Rome. Let's take a look at Rome. Here is ancient Rome in its glory. And in the Roman system, when they spoke language and did numerals and did mathematics, they had a system of writing. Every building you see some letters. These are called Roman numerals. So when John was given this vision about the number of a man, he was saying that the system of power that was going to rise in the last days over time, you can count the number of his name based on the prevailing system of what was happening at the time of the vision, the Roman Empire. Even in our United States today, you look at our buildings and it has Roman numerals on it. In February, we're watching Super Bowl, 56? Super Bowl, but we don't say Super Bowl 5-6. It uses a bunch of these Roman numerals, and I can't even read them anymore, right? It's like, what Super Bowl are we in now? Because I don't know about these Roman numeral systems. We still use Roman numeral systems today. For example, how many of you have a clock at home that uses these Roman numeral systems on your clock face? You see, without knowing, today we are still using Roman numerals. It's still applicable to us today. Okay, here is the code. Roman numerals are broken down this way. Snapshot this. When you see a 1 or an I, it's symbolic of a 1. Did you not know that in the Roman system, every letter is symbolic to a number? It's equal to a number. So if you have 3 I's in a row, it's 3. If you have a 5, it is a V. If you have a 10, it is an X. If you look at 1,000, it is an M. So according to the Bible, it says its number, the name of the man, is what should add up to the Roman numeral system 666. So I've presented some pretty indicting evidence against the pagan papal Roman system. I'm not downing Catholics. I'm not downing the Pope. I'm just saying about the system. Okay, let's take a look at it. Check out this crown here. This is called the Triple Crown. The Triple Crown is very symbolic. Let's go in a little bit closer here. Beautiful crown. He actually has 2 or 3 of these. Each crown represents that the Pope has temporal and spiritual power over heaven, over earth, and over death and Hades. That's the Triple Crown. It was added throughout the time, but this is the inaugural crown of the papacy. Okay? Let's go in a little bit closer here. Now, today, the papacy, they don't like wearing the tiara, but it's still in their flag. This is the papal flag at Vatican. Notice the papal, the tiara? Yeah. Okay, we're going to get into some symbols. You guys like the Da Vinci Code? Okay, I'm going to give you some Da Vinci Code symbols here. You see the 2 keys? That comes from the Bible. It says that Jesus told Peter he has the keys to heaven and hell. So they believe that the Catholic Church derives from St. Peter. But why gold and silver? Silver represents that the Pope has the powers to control everything that happens among all the world governments on earth, temporal. The gold represents that he has the power to control anything that happens on heaven and in death. Now, you notice something unusual. You have the Triple Crown. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. You see the keys, but what about the red cord? You know what the red cord represents? It is an ancient symbol that says that it derives its power from the ability to create blood. That's what it connects itself through all of history, martyrdom, blood. It is in the symbols of the papal church, and it has not changed in its history, okay? It is a royal symbol. Blood, we see. How many of you tie those red cords around your wrist to remember, okay? Very similar to that. In other words, the church is saying that we will remember its power that goes back to the time of the beginning. It has not changed. Okay. I'm going to focus a little closer here. Sorry for taking so much time, but you notice there's some letters that are written on the crown. This is the source of all of its story. Do you see that? You see those? It says, Vicarius Philidae. Now, up until this point, no one has been able to have access to these pictures. Only now, in 2020 and 2021, have I been able to secure actual pictures of the Triple Crown. I've been giving this sermon for 20, 30 years, and only now have I been able to show you a picture of the Vicarius Philidae. Let me show you the second crown. You see it circled? It's in bronze. It says Vicarius Philidae in the Roman system, Latin. Okay? Now, Vicarius Philidae. Let's take a look at this. Vicar or substitute of the Son of God. That's what it means. It means that they are the substitute of Jesus Christ on earth. What do you think? Blasphemy? I don't know. Let's see. You remember what we read in Revelation? Check this out. Our Sunday visitor, April 18th, 1915. Here's what they say. What are the letters inscribed in the Pope's crown, and what do they signify, if anything, Vicarius Philidae? The letters inscribed in the Pope's mitre are these, Vicarius Philidae, which is the Latin for vicar of the Son of God, or substitute of the Son of God. Okay, let's do some math now. Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, someone who will claim blasphemy. His number is 666. Check this out. Vicarius Philidae. You replace a number. For every one of those letters, Vicarius comes up to the number 112. Philae comes up to 53. Dei, or God, comes up to 501. You add 112 plus 53 to 501, that gives you 666. They wear it in their crown. They wear it in the crown. Vicarius Philidae. Now, some of you are saying, wow, that's cool. I've never seen that before. I heard this before. But some of you, I guarantee you, are gasping right now because you've never heard this before. I'm going to say, as the messenger, I feel for you. I understand this was not an easy sermon for me to give, but I'm telling you something. God said it, and this is history. It is what it is. You have to decide how you deal with it. Let's look at, again in close, the six identifying marks of the beast. Received the capital and power from Rome. Is a worldwide system of worship. We also notice that it claims privileges that belong only to God. It had persecuted Bible-believing Christians all through time. Okay? And let me tell you something. I mentioned to you about the ecclesiastical powers and laws of the Catholic Church. That has not changed, which means that the very things, the very rule of law that it governs itself by back in the time of 50 million martyrs still is powerful today as it was back then, which means that they can still do that to us today. It ruled supreme over Europe for 1,260 years according to the time prophecy, and the title of its very own Triple Crown adds up to 666. Today, we see a union now that we've never seen before. We've seen now the two beasts unified in such a way that we never thought or expected in this global climate change. Here we see in both Washington and in the Vatican, the United States and the Vatican are now becoming closer and closer. In fact, a recent article I read said that the two most powerful Catholics in the world are now meeting. You know who they were referring to, right? The Pope and President Biden. Okay? We're seeing this. Now, we're going to close out here. I apologize for keeping you, but I want you to take what I mentioned to you, and I want you to just pray on it. I knew I wasn't going to finish this whole sermon today, so next week we're going to talk about what is the mark of the beast, because you need to know what the mark of the beast is. We have now properly identified the first beast of Revelation 13 and the second beast of Revelation 13, and you know what's going to happen. It's going to happen in your lifetime. It's going to happen. What then is the mark of the beast? Okay, let's look at some options real quick. Is it a barcode scan on your forehead or on your arm? Maybe it's that. Or could it be COVID-19 paving the way for the mark of the beast? You know, this COVID-19 around the globe is causing everyone to receive this vaccine, who Bill Gates is trying to promote. What in the world is Microsoft doing with the vaccine? Could it be this, right? What is that? Or maybe what it is it's this barcode scan thing. It's a little chip that goes into your little area right here. Maybe they're going to mark us all, you know, with these microchips. Okay, could that be the mark of the beast? Here's one. Maybe it is a unique fingerprinting system. Have you all heard about this new technology? In fact, I don't know if you know this, but you already have this technology. on your iPhones and on your Samsungs. Did you know that you don't have to get into your phone using codes anymore? All you have to do is take your thumbprint or fingerprint and stick it on the little thing, and it reads your fingerprint. Is that not scary? Okay, any one of you guys doing that, you need to go back to a passcode. Okay, because it's reading, that this phone is reading your fingerprints. Okay, is it that? Could that be the mark of the beast? Or could it be the new microchip? You know, there's the new M1 microchip. It operates on the frequency of 666 hertz. Okay, pretty interesting, right? Could it be that? All right, next week we're going to talk about what the mark of the beast is. You don't want to miss what the mark of the beast is, because you do not want to receive that. Next week, we're going to look at what the seal of God is and what the mark of the beast is. Now, those of you watching online, I know some of you who are watching, you've emailed me. I know this has been pretty earth-shattering for some of you. We have quite a few Catholics that watch. But I know that at the end of the day, many of us are just honest, good people who want to have a relationship with Jesus. Amen? And this message that was delivered today, we typically do it in evangelistic meetings, but I feel like God is telling us that now it needs to be preached on our pulpits now. We need to get God's people ready for the end times, amen? Amen.